Good morning.
Flippin' physics.
Resonance involves standing wave patterns. So if you have not learned about standing waves, please enjoy my video about standing wave patterns. Link is in the description.
Here we go. As I slide my fingers across this aluminum rod, the friction between my hand and the rod causes vibrations which set up a standing wave pattern in the rod because the rod has a resonance frequency and resonance wavelength determined by the physical characteristics of the rod. Because I am holding the rod in the center of the rod, that forces the center of the rod to not vibrate. Bo, in terms of nodes and antinodes, what do you think that means for the movement of the rod?
Okay. The location you hold the rod at forces the rod to not vibrate there, so that must be a node. I'm guessing then that the two ends of the rod probably vibrate the most, which would make the two ends antinodes.
Correct. So you can hear that standing waves are happening in this rod. In other words, this rod is resonating, which is why this frequency you hear is called the resonance frequency of the rod. Another term often used is that this is the natural frequency of the rod. In other words, the friction between my fingers and the rod oscillate the rod at the resonance frequency of the rod, causing standing wave patterns in the rod, which is called resonance.
I'm sorry, what?
Yeah, I don't get it.
Okay, let's switch to a simpler example. This is a swing, which is a pendulum. A pendulum has a natural frequency at which it oscillates. If I apply a force to the pendulum at a frequency which matches the natural or resonance frequency of the pendulum, the amplitude of the pendulum will increase. The pendulum will be resonating due to my force applied at the natural frequency of the pendulum. If instead I apply a force to the pendulum which is at a frequency which does not match the natural frequency of the pendulum, the amplitude of the pendulum will not increase.
Sure. Applying a force at a frequency which closely matches the resonance frequency of the object will set up standing wave patterns in the object, which is called resonance.
Correct, Billy. We can do the same thing we did with the aluminum rod with a goblet. By running my damp finger over the top of this goblet, I set up a standing wave pattern in the goblet at its resonance frequency, which you can clearly hear. When I change the amount of water in the goblet, I can change the natural or resonance frequency of the goblet. You can even see that the vibrations of the goblet cause ripples in the water. A hollow tube has air in it, which will also resonate at particular frequencies, which is why if I hold an oscillating tuning fork over a hollow tube with one end in water, I can adjust the length of the hollow tube, which is filled with air, therefore changing the resonance frequency of the air column inside the tube until it matches the frequency of the tuning fork. And when the frequency of the tuning fork matches the resonance frequency of the air column inside the hollow tube, you can hear the louder standing wave pattern, which has been established in the air column inside the hollow tube. When I change the frequency of the tuning fork, you can see it changes the length of the tube, which is out of the water in which the standing wave pattern is created, and therefore changes the resonance frequency of the air column in the hollow tube. We can even take a very long hollow tube and adjust the frequency of the sound being played into the hollow tube and find the resonance frequency of this long hollow tube, which is 68 hertz. At this frequency, a standing wave pattern is created in the air inside the tube, and you can even feel the air oscillating at the end of the tube.
Maybe you can feel it, but we can't.
Oh, right. So I'll put a soap bubble in the end of the tube so you can see how the oscillating air vibrates the bubble.
Thanks, Mr. P. That's much better.
Actually, I cannot resist showing you slow motion of the bubble vibrating due to the oscillating air at the end of the hollow tube. I love this.
Me too.
Is this how musical instruments work?
Good point, Bobby. Wind instruments are instruments which create a pitch by vibrating a column of air inside the instrument. Examples of this would be horns, flutes, clarinets, penny whistles, and so forth. So yes, wind instruments create music by creating resonance waves or standing waves in the air column inside the instrument. In fact, this is exactly what you hear when you hold a large seashell to your ear. What you are hearing is various frequencies from the ambient noise setting up standing waves in the seashell at resonance frequencies for the air column inside the seashell.
and the frequencies which do not match the resonance frequencies in the air column in the seashell are dampened. That results in an echoey sound some people call the sound of the sea.
This speaker, which is from a pair of speakers I purchased in college, has resonance frequencies at low frequencies, which you can hear as I adjust the frequency of the sound being played by the speaker.
That is a terrible idea. Why would someone design a speaker with resonance frequencies?
Correct. It would be a terrible idea. What happened to this speaker is that I dropped the speaker too many times while moving in college. Evidently, dropping a speaker is not good for it. You can also hear the standing waves are not created in the speaker at higher frequencies.
One of my favorite practical examples of resonance frequency is resonance frequency of the human body. So what I have is a key fob and a human body, and what I can do is I can take the key fob and I can hold it right here and I can press the button. And what's going on here is the key fob sends out a radio wave, and that radio wave should reach my vehicle, the flipping physics vehicle in the back, but it does not. I'm just a little bit too far for that to work. So what I can do instead is I can hold the key fob right here. And what you can see is it now is able to reach the car. So what's going on is the frequency and wavelength of the key fob matches a resonance frequency and wavelength of my body, and therefore sets up a standing wave pattern in my body, which amplifies the signal and makes it so the radio waves can reach the car to lock and unlock the car.
Mr. Pete, can we go back to the original singing rod demonstration?
Sure, Bobby.
If your fingers are in the middle of the rod causing a node, and the ends of the rods are antinodes, that means the length of the rod is half the wavelength of the sound wave.
And if we measure the length of the rod, we can double it to determine the wavelength of the resonance wave set up in the rod.
Even better, if we could measure the frequency emitted by the rod, we can determine the speed of the wave in the rod using the equation speed equals frequency times wavelength.
The length of the rod is 0.750 meters, and frequency analysis of the sound says the frequency is 3,310 hertz. Have at it.
Then the wavelength of the wave in the standing wave pattern in this rod is 2 times the length of the rod, or 1.5 meters. Speed equals frequency times wavelength means that the speed of the wave in this rod is 3,310 times 1.5, or 4,965, well, with three sig figs, 4,960 meters per second.
Wow, just so you know, according to engineeringtoolbox.com, the speed of a wave in an aluminum rod like this is 5,000 meters per second. So our predicted wave speed is very close to the published wave speed.
Oh, wow.
Nice. Cool.
But what happens to the frequency if I do the same thing with a shorter aluminum rod? Let's say one which is 0.500 meters long.
Well, the situation is the same as before. However, the length of the rod is decreased. So because wavelength and frequency are inversely related, the frequency of the standing wave should be increased. We should hear a higher pitch.
And we can actually determine the frequency. There is still one node in the middle and two antinodes on the ends, so the length of the rod is still half a wavelength. That means the wavelength equals 2 times the length of the rod, so the wavelength equals 1 meter. We measured the speed of the wave in an aluminum rod to be 4,960 meters per second, and the frequency equals speed divided by wavelength, or 4,960 over 1. Therefore, the frequency emitted by the shorter aluminum rod should be 4,960 hertz.
Okay, let's test that. You can clearly hear the pitch is increased in the shorter rod,
and my analysis of the audio gives an average frequency of 4,960 hertz. I think we can definitely say the physics works. The physics works.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
The physics works. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.